Talk into
that's
it.
Fine.
Yeah.
Thank you for all joining us for this evening for this very timely and important movie and panel discussion. This is the type of programming offered by the Advocacy Committee, which we welcome any and all of you to join. Please see me later if you're interested in getting involved. I would like to thank Susan Pincus, one of our board members and Advocacy Committee member, for putting this project together. When you speak with her, you could also wish her a happy birthday.
Yay, happy birthday.
And if you're nice, she may even tell you how old she is. Since 1909, NCJWLA has assisted women, children, and families in need and has been a powerful catalyst for change, community service, and social justice. We have consistently honored our mission by educating the community about complex challenges such as domestic violence, reproductive rights, race and gender equality, health care, gun violence, and human trafficking. We also offer many volunteer opportunities for which you will find more information on the table in the lobby as you leave. On your chair, you will find a program with bios of each of our panelists, a white card to write down questions for the panel, and a volunteer will pick them up, and a yellow evaluation form to be completed as you leave. You will also find a flyer for our event on November 18th at 6 p.m., organized by the National Council of Jewish Women LA Community Mental Health and Supportive Services Department, which will be showing the film trailer of The S Word, followed by a dialogue and panel discussion about suicide. Yeah. This is a very serious problem in our society, and I hope you will all attend. NCJW is also looking forward to our annual clothing giveaway on Sunday, December 6th, from 8 a.m. to 12 noon. Each year, we give away thousands of pieces of clothing to people in our community. We need many volunteers for this project, so I hope each of you can donate a couple of hours of your time. You'll find more information for upcoming events and volunteer opportunities on the table outside the door. This evening's program, Bridging the Divide, Tom Bradley and the Politics of Race, tells the story of how Tom Bradley, the first African-American mayor of a major U.S. city with an overwhelming white majority, was elected by forming an extraordinary coalition of African-American, Jews, white liberals, Mexican-Americans, and Asian-Americans. The Q&A following the movie includes panelists Lorraine Bradley, Bill Boyarsky, Lynn Goldfarb, and Allison Sotomayor, and will be moderated by Susan Frodenheim. So I will introduce them after the film. You don't want to miss this panel. We're going to start the panel discussion right now. I'll be starting by introducing the moderator, Susan Frodenheim. Susan has been executive editor of the Jewish Journal since 2011 and served as managing editor from 2006 to 2011. She oversees the day-to-day management of the newspaper's editorial staff, assigning and editing news features, arts and editorial columnists, and occasionally writing articles and columns. From 1990 until 2003, she worked as an assigning editor and writer at the Los Angeles Times, most of it as arts editor, a senior position in the Times calendar section. Susan has also written for the New York Times and many national magazines and newspapers. Susan will be introducing the panel. Thank you.
Thank you so much. All right, we have an amazing panel here. Next to me is Lynn Goldfarb, who's the producer, writer, and director of Bridging the Divide. And Goldfarb's previous work includes With Babies and Banners, the television series The Great Depression, The Great War, PBS's California and the American Dream, and The New Los Angeles. And I was going to go to Allison next because they worked together on the film. Allison is at the end. Allison Sotomayor is the producer, research director, and writer of the film. And 10 years as a producer of the KCET TV news and culture program Life and Times, which I'm sure many of you have seen. And she also assisted in producing the new Los Angeles with Lynn. And then Lorraine Bradley. We're so lucky to have Lorraine here. A retired school teacher and the daughter of the late Los Angeles Mayor Tom Bradley. And she also served as an advisor for community relations on the Los Angeles Human Relations Commission of the Housing and Community Department. And then finally, Bill Boyarsky, who I'm sure many of you have read in many venues over the years, including the Jewish Journal, and the LA Observed, and Tuftig right now, but he's probably best known in this community as the LA Times reporter, editor, and columnist, writing about Tom Bradley from his 1969 losing campaign through his entire tenure as mayor. So Bill will have lots of insight into the journalists and the Jewish persons. it's really great to have all of you here. And I thought first we could just start with a few words from Lorraine. I would like to start with you, because I think starting with the man and the father is a really wonderful place to start. And I just wondered if, before we went in today, and I've seen this film before and spoken with all but Bill about it at another venue. And one of the things that I think is so remarkable is just to see this person come to life for us once again. And I wondered if you could talk a little bit about how it feels for you to see your dad and to remember.
Well, of course, for me, it brings back great memories. It was a great time. He was a wonderful father. And he did a lot of great things for the city that he absolutely loved. This is why he stayed here so long. He had opportunities other places, but he always felt he could do more in Los Angeles and be a leader for it. And for me and my sister Phyllis, it's just great to know that people are going to now remember. Those many of you here knew Tom Bradley because you grew up with him or are associated. There's 9 million stories out there, people I always meet who have a Tom Bradley story. It's terrific. And because he was out there, he touched so many people and so many lives. And so it's great for us to be able to see and for the young people to experience, because they don't know who Tom Bradley is. They see the city, they see the airport, they see other things, and they really don't know who that person is. So for me, it's a way for us to communicate that and show them what transpired over the years and what's possible even for them as the future. And so it's great. I want to thank all of you for coming out, and we appreciate your time. Thank you.
What's so great about this film is that it captures so many issues that concern us today and shows the precedent that, you know, that was set 30 years, I guess you'd say? 40? Depends on where you start. Okay, so Lynn, I just wanted to talk about putting the film, and Allison, both of you, to talk a little bit about putting the film together and how much of a challenge it was, and did you know Bradley in his lifetime, and just talk a little bit about the inspiration for it. Starting with Lynn.
Okay, unfortunately, I never got to meet Tom Bradley, and so I'm meeting him and learning about him through the people that we interviewed, through the footage we found, through the research that we did. And the more this film took, you know, more than 7 years to make.
Oh, wow.
We started during the election of Obama, and we thought, oh, this will be easy. We should have known better. No film is easy. But we were electing the first black president, and so many people believe that Tom Bradley, as Wanda said, laid the roadmap, and we thought this would be the time, this would be the appropriate time to tell the story of Tom Bradley. And it just took much, much longer to raise the money. I think that was probably our biggest challenge. But the other challenge, and I think Allison can talk a little bit about that as well, was the research that it took to make the film. And I'm just going to say one other thing, and then we'll turn it over to Allison. And that is that I was motivated to make the film because I grew up in Los Angeles, and I saw how, and then I went away for a number of years, you know, to college and graduate school, and then came back, and I realized how much LA had changed. And I wanted to understand how Los Angeles changed. And I felt that Tom Bradley's story is the key to the transformation of Los Angeles. And by making this film, we would put him back into the history. And so many times people have said that Los Angeles doesn't have a history. Or they say Los Angeles is Hollywood. And that's always upset me. And so I felt like I really wanted to make a film that could show the real history of Los Angeles and how vital and important and progressive we are.
I just first want to say thank you for having us here. I mean, it's an honor to have Susan moderate the panel. We love your work from afar. Thank you to the National Council for Jewish Women Los Angeles. Again, we are honored. Thank you, Maya, Donna, Hillary. For myself, when we started this project in 2008, Lynn was right. It was during the campaign of Obama. And at that time, we came together and we realized something that was quite amazing and surprising to us. And that was Tom Bradley's story was not being taught in our schools. It was virtually absent in our history books. And what did that say about his life and legacy? That it was distorted, that it was nearly forgotten, and that he had become marginalized. So we started this quest, we began this quest to reignite the interest in Tom Bradley. First of all, because he was historically significant. I mean, here is a man who is a symbol of racial conciliation, a symbol of hope, a symbol of opportunity. And a film, a documentary had not been done on him. It was amazing to us. And so we embarked on this journey. Actually, it took almost 8 years to do. We also produced a second altogether different film. It's geared just for the schools. It's an educational version. And we have that film distributed throughout the Los Angeles Unified School Districts, all 150 schools. We're really excited about that. But we also wanted to do this because we wanted to inspire people, especially the young people. I mean, don't young people all need role models? Don't we all need uplifting stories like this? So those were kind of all the reasons why we decided to embark on this journey. And one of the big challenges that Lynn mentioned in terms of doing this documentary was the fundraising, but it was also taking together probably hundreds of hours and thousands of stills, and hundreds of hours of footage, thousands of stills, combining that, putting a story together, putting an arc together, connecting the themes, bringing all the people together that we talked to over the course of years. I mean, we did 135 pre-interviews before we even did the 50 HD interviews for the film, and each interview that we did for the film was about 2 hours in length. So out of those 50 interviews, 40 ended up in the film. You know, so it was condensing this story into a 57-minute story that flowed and that made sense. And so that was a huge challenge for us, but also just to locate the visuals. I mean, Los Angeles has kind of been a bad way of looking at our history. When we reached out to all the local TV stations, for example, to try to get footage of Tom Bradley during the 1982 gubernatorial campaign, we were surprised to find out that they did not save that footage.
Wow.
All those, the field tapes, a lot of the air checks, interviews, we were stunned. And so we had to go to national network broadcasts and obtain footage there. I mean, we were calling all over the state of California, and we found very, very little footage of Tom Bradley. And that was because they didn't start saving the air checks, the field tapes, until 1991 when Rodney King was beat.
Mm-hmm.
So that was another great big challenge for us. And, you know, it didn't stop us. You know, we did this film with great personal sacrifice, and we did it because we believed in the message, we believed in the story, we believe in the hope that admits them. So thank you very much for being here. Welcome.
I'm so glad you had that kind of persistence and commitment, because that's what gives us this gift. Bill, you were the observer, you were the recorder, you were the critic, and all sorts of things throughout. Can you give us, just start by giving us some of your impressions of Bradley and what kind of a leader he was?
Well, first of all, I really admired him as a person, as a man, as a great unifying force in the city, as a really an honest person, and a person who had great skills as a political leader. He's also a very tough guy. I mean, he was tough.
Can you give an example?
Well, I remember one of my favorite examples was the second campaign against Yorty in 1973. They had a debate on television, in 69, as the film said, Yorty had walked all over Bradley with this racist campaign, and so these two of them get up there for this debate, and the first thing Bradley says is he accuses Yorty of being in the pay of mob bosses. Well, Yorty was like somebody hit him below the belt, but he was tough, and I thought that debate was sort of a turning point, because it took a lot of the steam out of Yorty. As a journalist, he was a challenge to deal with, because as the film pointed out, he was very closed. He didn't talk about himself much. He thought that would be a bad sportsmanship, or he was of a generation that didn't do that, and so it was hard for him to. And it was hard for me as a reporter, who was always looking for human interest things to get it out of him. But just finally, I do remember one thing really sticks in my mind. I was a city county bureau chief, and I was in charge of all the coverage of him. And he was, we covered it pretty intensely, really did. We had a wonderful reporter on him named Nancy Skelton. And he was didn't like this. So I got a call one afternoon from his press secretary, Allie Webb, and she said, "The boss wants to see you." And I says, "Oh?" She says, "Yeah." She says, "Now." Well, you know, if it had been a normal, if it had been in most people, I would have said I'm busy, or I would have lied, or I wouldn't have done it. But I said, okay. So I go over to City Hall, go into his office, and he's sitting there at his desk, and he has all these stories that our bureau had done, including some by me. And he had underlined them. You know, a school teacher or an editor read, here, he didn't like this. And we sat there for a long time, and we went over every story.
Oh,
I mean, every story. And sometimes, I thought he had a good point. Other times I thought he was wrong, you know, and I'd say, no, I think you're wrong on that. We argued back and forth over every story. Finally, we were done. And he says, well, I just want to thank you for, you know, taking the time, coming over, and going through all these stories. And I said, well, I just want to tell you that I really admire you as a man. You know, a lot of people in your position would have called up my publisher or my editor and whined to them. I said, but you didn't do that. You wanted to face me face to face. And I thought that was pretty damn good. And we left on good terms.
That's really it speaks so much to the man. The notion of coalitions and coalition building that kind of came together, Jews and blacks as one of them, is such an... it's interesting from the perspective now, because sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. I mean, the film even showed that the coalitions came together to elect the mayor, and then they fell apart during the riots. And then I just wondered how much of that has lasted, and how he made it happen as well. Maybe Lorraine, you could talk about the how we made it happen, and Bill and others can jump in.
Well, my mother used to always say that he belonged to 62 organizations, worked every day, cut lawns for the neighbors, et cetera, did extra things for he and mom, did extra things to make extra money, because what was it, $170 or something a month, and everybody went, yeah, well, put that in perspective. I don't even know how you survive, but anyway, and he was always doing things. And so from the beginning, that was what he did. When he became mayor, one of the things that impressed all of the mayors, the National League of Cities was incorporated every mayor from every city, doesn't matter how big or small it was. And for the mayor of Los Angeles to show up, number one, never happened. And number two, to actually care about what they thought, because his idea was that, and this is what he did all the time, he met with people, he got what ideas they had, and then he decided what he was going to do to help most of the people. And even then, it was like, he's listening to us, he cares about us, and he said to them, we're all in this together, in this economy and other things that go on. It doesn't matter if you're a big city or a little city. Everybody has to has problems, and we can't solve them all unless we all talk about them and work together. And I mean, they eventually elected him the president of their organization. But the fact that he showed up and cared was impressed all of them, because he thought, you know, this never happens. But that's what my dad did. He did this all the time. This is why people, when they see him or talk to him or talk about him, we're always amazed. But he had been doing this since he was young. Same thing when they talked about his high school. He was the first black Ophelian in the Honor Society at his high school. He was the first of everything. He ran for a student body president. No, he didn't win, but that didn't keep him from running. The counselors all wanted him to take Volk Ed. He said, no, I'm going to college. That's what he did. As you saw in the film, he was president of the Negro organization at his college. At every level, he spent most of his life in the police department as in the media area. He started that department, and they would go out and talk to schools. He was used to talking and interacting with all kinds of people, because he went to schools to talk to kids about their careers and how life would be if they went to school and stayed in school and this kind of thing. So he was always doing that. So for him to... just because he became mayor or whatever, didn't none of that stopped. He'd been doing that all his life, so it was easy for him to transition to that. Obviously, you're talking to more people and have a bigger impact, higher up you go on the ladder, but the bottom line is the process is always the same. If you talk to people and if you listen to what they're saying, whether you agree with what they have to say or not, it doesn't matter. If you're listening to them, everybody feels that they have a part and a vested interest in something, because you're listening to what they have to say. And that was Daddy.
Anyone else have something to build?
Well, he spent a lot of time you know, going out to, he went to Temple, well, certainly more than I ever. he went to, many synagogues, and after he lost in 1969, he started, as he said in the film, he started campaigning immediately. And I went around with him a lot in those years between before he the 73 election. I'd follow him around, and I mean, we'd go out to the Pacific Palisades and the Valley, all the white areas. These were all white areas, and he had this. You could see that this things were changing. He had this incredibly warm, friendly reception. I mean, people hugging him, women hugging him, guys. I mean, he was just well loved, but because he had been there an awful lot, so he really worked hard on it. He couldn't really overcome the Farrakhan was there. That was a decisive, difficult thing, and you saw Janet Clayton, she talked in the film, and we were both covering that at the same time. We were covering it together, and we'd go out there, during the day and covering various aspects of it, and then we'd come back in and we'd write our story, we talk about it and what was behind it. And she said, I hope I get this right, she said that it was an irreconcilable situation because it touched on the greatest fears of Jews and blacks, black men, of Jews, Farrakhan, with his anti-Semitism. He raised the fears of the Holocaust, the deepest fears of the Jewish people. And the reaction to him and the demands from the Jewish community that Bradley apologized, and that went on for a long time before he did not apologize, before he condemned Farrakhan. That went on for some time. Those demands, she pointed out, that went to the deepest fears of the African-American community, particularly African-American men, of being told what to do, by white people. And so we both talked about it. It was very interesting, this middle-aged white guy and this young African-American journalist working on it and talking about it. I thought what she said was pretty smart and true, and that was why it was really hard in the years that followed to revive that, wonderful golden coalition of 1973.
No, go ahead. I just want to say something, which is that when I listened to you, Bill, we actually interviewed Bill for that film. And we had him in the film so many times and actually telling almost many of the stories that you just told. And because of the time and the way that we had to cut the story, you kept ending up on the cutting room floor.
Oh, come on.
We didn't mean that.
Wait a minute. It was age discrimination.
But listening to you again, you are such a wonderful storyteller, and we really miss having you in the film.
But I do want to get back to the notion of coalitions that Susan brings up about, because to me it's very interesting. It's remarkable that Tom Bradley reached across racial and ethnic lines to create and this extraordinary coalition. But what's even more remarkable to me is that he was able to sustain it for so long, because coalitions have these strains and pushes and limitations, and as we suggest in the film, it frayed and unraveled at certain points towards the latter part of his mayoralship. But I think one of the reasons why I think Bradley was able to kind of sustain the coalition for so long was simply because of Tom Bradley and his persona. I mean, he really made a deliberate decision to create this kind of non-threatening persona. You know, he had this kind of low key approach to governance and approaching the people, and people were not scared of him. You know, very much how I kind of see Obama. I mean, he is very much, in my eyes, non-threatening. He's able to reach across racial and ethnic lines and able to navigate really well in all the in the black and white world, so much like Tom Bradley did many years ago. So yeah, it's a very interesting question in terms of coalitions, and you can look at that link, as we suggest in the film, between Obama and Bradley, kind of in that coalition.
Things that you're saying are bringing up the issue, which is one of the questions here, or one of the comments from the audience, which is, you know, the more things change and the more time goes by, the more it's exactly the same. And, you know, the Watts riots defined, you know, early in his life, and then there were the 1992 Rodney King riots, and now we're looking at Black Lives Matter and the riots all over the country with Ferguson and so forth, and you have, it also shows you how you can have so much hope invested in an individual to show that, you know, we've crossed those boundaries and we can get along, and then it's clear that one man can be extraordinary and still not change the world. So I just wondered if, you know, I think you did an amazing job with the film in kind of reminding us of that without having to throw it in our face, but still I wondered if you could talk about that a little bit.
One of the major feelings that we had is that, you know, it took us so long to finish the film that that by the time we did release it, the events were so much more pertinent and important. And in a funny way that, we're glad it took us this long because we feel that the film can help to, you know, encourage a dialogue. And it does raise a lot of the same questions that are happening now. And so, we always felt that we're not doing a history. We're telling this, you know, we're telling a historical story, but we're framing it with subjects that resonate now. And, you know, unfortunately, they're resonating more than we thought they would, you know, at this point in time.
It was purely coincidental, but we're happy that it's out now because it is very relevant. And we want people to walk away, audiences and young audiences, walk away with a better understanding of race, to, like Lynn talked about, to dialogue and converse more. And again, having to walk away with that feeling of hope, it also brings the feeling of despair when you think about everything that's going on now. But we got to keep looking towards the positive. And Lorraine talks a lot about this. People are bickering, screaming all the time. We need to get together and talk. And this is what we are hoping that this film will do, is promote dialogue, promote conversation among all people, despite the hue of your skin.
Does anyone know, one of the questions is, does anyone know whether President Obama was aware or steeped in the history of Bradley?
Well, we understand he was attending, I think, his Occidental.
Yeah.
He was at Occidental at the same time that Daddy was in office, so he was aware of Tom Bradley. I got to meet the president at one of the speeches he made early in his first term and introduced myself, and he thanked me on behalf of my father for my dad's service. So yes, he was aware, but again, and the biggest part, it was a negative fact, was, you know, the first time he ran, they talked about the Bradley effect, which in reality was about the fact that you couldn't rely, because you had a person of one race and a person of a different race, You couldn't rely on exit polls to tell you what they used to be. If there was a 3% margin of error when they took the polls, they wouldn't project a winner in any particular thing. They relied on that as they were taking polls, and that's what they relied on. People came out of the polling booths, they were asked, and they said they voted for Tom Bradley. And yet, they didn't, because he didn't win. And so all the percentages now go up, so the bottom line is that you can't, so the Obama campaign could not rely on the fact that, okay, we might be 3%, but is that really 3%? Do we need to be 5 or 6% ahead of the opponent because of the race issue? And so because of that, that's what the Bradley effect actually is. But it became a negative connotation because of that, and everybody saw it as that. But in reality, it was just a reality check. You cannot rely on a small percentage to be the barometer for whether or not you win or lose. And if you choose that and take that 3% and think that it's a point of victory, you can't rely on it because people come out and they lie. That's the bottom line.
But certainly we did have the intention of interviewing Obama, and we just didn't get a chance to because of funding problems, but we did have that intention.
This is a question for the entire panel. Do you think that that there's anything that came from the lessons that of how Bradley governed that should be applied today more than are being applied? I mean, seems to me, for one thing, the issue that you raised of people actually talking to one another might be one part of it, but maybe you can go deeper.
That's the base issue. Let's face it. If you don't listen to what people have to tell you, whether you like it or not, how do you make a good decision? You know, whether you appreciated what somebody's final choice was or not, at least they gave it a shot. You at least got a say into what went on, and that's not what's happening now. Obviously, the president tries and relies on that a lot with his advisors and who he listens to, and a lot of leaders try that. The public and we have to be more, we have to be out there more to try to help some of these issues instead of getting behind the people who are trying to stir up more trouble instead of listening. Their objective is one thing, and there are way too many good people out here to let that force continue having a say. So we just have to be more vigilant, and we have to do a better job of being out there. Young people are a way to do that. I hope this film manages to touch them. Lynn and I did a workshop last month, wasn't it, with young people.
Right, with Facing History and Ourselves.
Yeah, and the kids come from high schools. The kids, it was the teachers, the students, and parents. And they were immersed in Tom Bradley all day. They couldn't believe it. I mean, they were coming up with all kinds of suggestions and more, and all kinds of slogans that they had. And one of the cute things was in one of the groups, who they thought Tom Bradley was, and they drew made a copy of the skyline, because as we said, that's Tom Bradley's skyline. That's what he built. And so they drew a copy of it because they thought that was what Tom Bradley represented. So it was kind of cute, but they were singing and having a good time, and they really got into it. And it's that kind of enthusiasm that we hope will lend itself to more dialogue and more talking.
Not just the skyline, the metro, the Olympics.
Well, yeah.
I mean, you know,
a lot of things, but
you don't
get credit.
Some aspects to it.
Yeah, well, like he talked about the Olympic movement. You know, he saved the Olympic movement. Doesn't get credit for that. The Metro Line doesn't get credit for that. Somebody mentioned that they thought he should be called the father of the Metro Line. But the bottom line is, for him, it was about the work, not necessarily all about the glory, which is why Bill had some problems making that personal connection when he would try to write a story, because Daddy wasn't raised that way, that he had to take credit for everything. It was all about the work, the result, and what went on. If he didn't get the credit for it, fine. As long as it got done, that was what he was all about.
One day I asked him, I was just desperate to make a human being out of this. So I had to do a profile of him. So I said, well, what do you do every day? Well, he says, well, what do you mean? I said, well, okay, you get up. Well, what do? I mean, so then he described what he did all day. You know, he'd get in the car, and they'd drive him to work, and he'd see some potholes, and he'd phone. I mean, then, well, he got into the details of what he did all day. It was very interesting, and, you know, that was one thing. He wasn't just this person who, you know, spread fairy dust all over the city. He was a very good politician, and the reason he accomplished a lot was because he really did understand city government. I mean, he was a student of every detail of city government, from the smallest pothole to building a subway, and he understood how it could be done. And he was also, he had been in the city council for 2 terms, I think. He was also a student of the city council. And even though he had sharp disagreements with some of the council members, the president, John Ferraro, ran against him for mayor one time, they all respected each other because these council people really respected somebody who, you know, just gets himself right in the nitty-gritty details of what they do, and could talk to them on their terms about the budget and all of that. And so that was really one reason he was able to accomplish as much as he did.
I think also we shouldn't overlook the fact that he had an adversarial relationship with the police chief, and yet won that battle too by the end. I mean, he was able to form that commission, mm-hmm. and to ultimately, after terrible circumstances, to get rid of Gates, which is huge,
yeah.
And change the city.
Exactly.
I mean, there's so many ways in which he changed the city. So I'm going to go through a few of these questions, some of which we've already covered from the audience, but they're very good questions. So one of them is about distribution of the film. Do you see the film? You're bringing it into the schools. Is it going to be shown otherwise, or are these events the way that you're doing it? Is there any hope of seeing it on TV, perhaps, or
PBS?
You want to tell?
You talk.
Well, the film was first broadcasted locally a few months ago on PBS SoCal, that's located out in Costa Mesa. But we are distributing the film to PBS, who will be feeding it to all the stations in February of 2016, marking Black History Month.
Right.
So you have to check your local listings, your PBS local listings, so you can expect it to air nationally in February. But one of the challenges, and you mentioned challenges earlier, Susan, is, and I'm looking at pre-production, production, and now post-production, is raising money for this outreach so that we can continue to do screenings like this. Can continue to reach out to schools and young people. I mean, that is our next big phase, and we are right in the middle of that campaign, and we're selling DVDs and posters on our website and at various screenings, but we think it's really important to be able to continue to distribute this, not to do a film for 7-8 years and just let it die on a shelf. You know, we want this film to be seen. We want dialogue to happen. So we are embarking on this community outreach, community engagement campaign. If you're interested in donating to this campaign, you can talk to us after the Q&A.
And everybody, you got a postcard at your seat that talks about the outreach campaign and also reaching out to universities and colleges. But really, the way that this distribution will happen is by word of mouth and by networking. And if you like this, if you like it, talk to somebody else. If you're part of an organization, let them know about it. If you're, you know, connected with a school, let them know about it. We're happy to do screenings, to provide copies, to help facilitate how people are able to see the documentary.
Yeah, we mentioned that we sent it out, that LA Unified distributed it to all the schools. Our problem is we don't know if they're showing it. Like we've reached out to UTLA and are still still continue to make that phone call to find out if they got feedback from their chapter chairs. But again, it's a process. You can give it to all that we want, but if nobody shows it, it doesn't do too much good. And a lot of things, they sent one copy to the principal or whoever was in charge of the school, and it's up to them to distribute it. Well, as an former administrator, sometimes the envelopes don't get opened in the right place or the stuff distributed. So, but we're trying to do that. But if any of you have any influence any place or are not only LA Unified, but with, you know, private schools or charter schools or whatever, and you know some organizations that would love to see the film, we'd love to show it. And I'll show up any place.
And Lorraine will do that, that's for sure. But along with the film, though, it's also packaged with a CD of two very comprehensive curriculums, one for 11th grade history and the other for 12th grade government classes. And we spent a lot of time, we worked with a curriculum designer that was highly recommended by the LAUSD to compile and create these curriculums that are designed and aligned to Common Core standards. Mm. So that's also available with the film for educational use.
And I want to mention one other thing. If you're part of any organizations that are statewide or national, it would be very helpful because those are the organizations that we need to reach now to make sure that when the film is released nationally in February, that they'll, you know, let their constituencies know about it.
So there's also a suggestion that Bill Boyarsky should write his a book about the Bradley years.
All right.
Pull out those old interviews, Bill. I wanted to mention one other thing. One of the panels that I was on, the panel that I was on previously about this film, George Takei was on it, which was amazing. And he mentioned that as a Japanese American, that how much Bradley would get involved and have and come to the neighborhood, and that his parents hosted Bradley in his home. Mm-hmm. And then he also talked about how Bradley was very receptive to the gay community. Did I see something in the film about HIV/AIDS?
AIDS walk.
Yeah, he was on the forefront for that and the discrimination that went on with that. He was also the leader who made the city, had the city boycott apartheid from South Africa. It was the first major city to do that. He led the fight for that, and which is one of the reasons why you saw at the latter part the one picture of Nelson Mandela and that. When he wanted to visit Los Angeles as one of his stops on this tour after he was released, and that's part of the reason for it, that he was at the forefront. But he was at the forefront of a lot of issues because he felt that was important to all of the people in Los Angeles. And Bill talks about the fact that he couldn't get a lot of information about, I grew up with the man, so we know his humor, he loved a good joke. He was crazy about nuts. That's what I gave him every Christmas or his birthday was, always had to find nuts. Because he was so poor when he grew up, he didn't really have that many, the clothes and the shoes. So he shopped for himself. People were shocked when he'd be in the store and he'd be buying, what's the mayor doing in here? Buying whatever I need to buy, you know, whatever. Or I'd get him something for Christmas. It was always revolved around the shoe cleaning set, because he'd sit there and polish all those shoes. So I had to get creative every year with finding the ones with the battery operated, so he wouldn't have to press so hard, et cetera, et cetera. But those are the kind of things. We had a barbecue every 4th of July out in the yard, and all the relatives came, and he and Mom cooked. He built the brick barbecue in the backyard, and they took care of ribs and stuff, and we put up the badminton net, croquet, and the ping pong tables, and everybody had a good time. But that was my dad when he wasn't working. He unfortunately worked 16 hours a day, 7 days a week when he became mayor. And he didn't have a lot of time for that, but he loved sports. Our tradition was USC, UCLA football game every year. And we went to that. That was traditional around Thanksgiving time. We always went to that. He supported both teams when it was necessary, but obviously Bruins more than Trojans. when I was growing up, because I love sports too, he and I would trace down to the Coliseum and do all of the relay races and stuff when the track was really prominent here in the city. And every year they had the big track meet at the Coliseum. That's where we went every year, watching the meets and partaking in that. So, of course, when the Olympics came, he went to every event, almost every event, because there wasn't any traffic. He could go from downtown L.A. to any place in the city in 10 minutes because everybody left town. Then when they found out there wasn't any traffic, they all came back. But before that, and so that was what my father was like. And so the public persona was much different because it needed to be as far as he was concerned. But the personal persona was always about having a good time. He loved to have conversations with people. He had a great time with the family, and I had a lot of get-togethers when I was very, very young and didn't really know anything. He and my mom always had folks over for bridge and cards and stuff once a month, and mom loved to cook and loved to bake, and so they'd always do that. And so that was his life, and politics got in the way of a lot of that once he became the mayor of Los Angeles and served everybody. But he still was my dad, and still we did a lot of things together, so it was good.
Thank you. I think this has been amazing. I will allow you any last words, but I want to thank all of you and thank NCJW for hosting us tonight, because it's really been, it's great to bring this back and bring it alive, and also to humanize a mythic figure now, and also somebody whose name is, you know, adorning airports, but not necessarily as humanized as he is through this film, and also through the comments of particularly Bill and Lorraine, but through the film that you and that Allison and Lynn made as well.
Thank you all for coming.